Zoom protocol, I guess that we've all been through this enough to know. Try not to use the chat. Use the thing. Raise your hand. If we're in a screen share and you raise your hand and I don't see you, then just unmute and holler and I will recognize you. Next up, we've got agenda review. Does anybody need to make an adjustment to the agenda? Seeing none, next would be approval of the Zoom summary. And that would be an action item. So I need a motion from somebody to approve the
Zoom. This is Howard, summary. I'll move approval.
And a second.
A second.
Bill, seconds. All in favor, raise your hand. Looks unanimous. Opposed? John, abstaining? Jennifer, thank you, because you weren't there. Perfect. All right, now I'm going to pass it off to EETAC's bylaw amendments, and this is Elena.
Great. I will share my screen. I'm just going to walk through the edits that we are proposing. I sent that out. I don't know if some folks had a chance to go over it. Most things are straightforward, but I'm just going to share my screen and ask questions as they come up. All right. So in the beginning, we have crossed out any references to urban reserves since we are sort of past that process with EETAC, and instead have added doing some UGB analysis, which we discussed with you all, I think, at last meeting. And so just kind of made those strike-throughs and edits to the purpose of EETAC and the roles and responsibilities of EETAC in the beginning here. And added a note about staff duties to record and post the videos since we've been virtual. I changed to some gender neutral language around he, she to member. And then in terms of member composition, we had been at a minimum of 12 and a maximum of 15. And recently we've had a few members that we've lost and we've gone below that 12 number. So to kind of build in a little bit more flexibility, we're proposing to drop that to 10 and keep it at a max of 15. And also this kind of brings it in line with our, the Active Transportation Advisory Committee, which is also advisory to staff, similar to EETAC. Their bylaws say at least 10 and not more than 15. So similar group. And so that's what we're proposing, to drop that to 10. Heather?
I just wanted to also add on that, because I know we had a lot of discussion at the technical resource group when we talked about numbers. And what I remember from that conversation was that the most important thing is that we've got a wide variety of interests, background, and some of the key topic areas that this work entails, that we have some expertise and interest in those areas. And so I think one of the things that I like that it's in alignment with the other committee, like Elena said, that is similar to that we actually use their bylaws when we developed these bylaws. But I think what I really like is the focus more on, if we need to do recruitment, I hope that it's more about that we're missing some topic area interest or expertise, and not necessarily we just need, you know, before it was 12 people. I mean, if we have 10 folks and we've got a good representation, you know, 10 feels pretty manageable. But again, not stuck on that, but just wanted to mention part of that. This is a little bit more of a discretionary part than some of the rest of it. So I just wanted to mention a little bit more about why we did that.
It's like Dennis.
Yeah, the next piece that I noticed, the city manager shall appoint with, you know, diversities included in the goals. And particularly tonight, it seems like there's a gender imbalance. And so whether or not it would be appropriate for us to make a recommendation to the city manager to look particularly for ethnic and gender diversity more than currently exists on the panel. And part of that, I'm particularly sensitive. I was a preschool director and the gender leanings were often far different in many meetings I went to. So I have a past habit of kind of counting sometimes. So I wonder if we might make a recommendation about to the city manager's office to make an effort to increase diversity.
It does say diverse gender and ethnicity backgrounds in the bylaws here.
My point is, I don't think we're all that diverse.
And I had a question there where it says paid and unpaid.
Mm-hmm.
Same paragraph, section D.
I don't know what that means.
Well, I'm just, you know, I'm just... Yeah. I'll give you my address for my check. and the back wages shouldn't be more than $3,000 or $4,000.
I don't remember the intent of the paid and unpaid either. But I will say that we are planning to go out for recruitment. And so that's something that when we do that this spring, well, actually just in a couple months, we'll probably have more discussion at this group about where are the areas that we would like to specifically highlight when we're in recruitment. So I don't think we have to do that now.
But I think since we're editing
should we strike these, that language?
I would say just take out paid and unpaid.
Yeah, that sounds good to me, since we're not exactly sure what that means.
Well, I have a question about that one. I expect that paid and unpaid refers to those participants who are members of organizations that we want to include, mm-hmm. And who happen to be paid by their organization to do this kind of thing. And so, I mean, that's what I have assumed was the intent of that clause.
Okay.
Or that phrase.
Okay, I've got Phil, and then Jennifer had her hand, but I don't know if she still needs to talk. Okay.
Yeah, I was just wondering if maybe the genesis of this may have come from another set of bylaws, since the city did this other public outreach process that did involve paying the attendees. So maybe it's just a relic of that. I would say strike it. So
Heather.
I think Mark is right. I think it is from trying to get at whether or not folks are paid to participate, you know, if this is part of their job, is participating in this committee or not. But it's certainly not clear. So I think if we want to say that, we could clarify that instead of just strike. I mean, we could strike it, but we could rephrase it to make that clear, more clear.
I guess I would ask, well, we can go through the rest of the changes and then we'll come back to that and see if anybody has a strong feeling one way or another.
Okay. Sue?
If the intent of eliminating that is to eliminate people, for instance, like Ed McMahon, who was employed in this position, but also had a tremendous amount of not only work experience, but perspective on all of these issues, then I would not want to eliminate the potential that somebody like that could be involved. So I mean, obviously we just have to be careful about all of that.
Yeah, and I don't think that would be the intention. I think it would really just be make this a little bit less, make it more clear. And that wouldn't, you know, preclude pursuing folks like Ed or people who were paid through their organizations. Great. We can circle back. Okay. And then in terms of the recruitment process, we will be filling vacancies in conjunction with the other cities, boards, and commissions. Already talked to the city manager's office about recruitment in the next couple of months. And then we just updated some of this language to reference how the first group of folks were chosen, to use past tense since that was already done, but this is good context, so we wanted to leave it in. And then in terms of folks who may want to continue serving, the practice hasn't been that they apply. We've really just reappointed them, so changed that language to match what we've been doing already. And then for election of officers, I switched up the language so that we will plan to have elections in June, and then the term of office will begin July 1 or upon election and serve through June 30th. Our officer elections have gotten a little wonky. We were doing them in October and July and kind of all over the place. So this at least will try and get us more on track, and instead of serving a one-year term, it'll really be to serve through the next June 30th when we end up having those elections. And same for a special election. So just at the, you know, last meeting or so, we elected John as co-chair, which was in December, and he'll just serve through June 30. And so that just kind of helps better align us with some of the other boards and commissions appointments and just get us on track a little bit more. And then in terms of meetings, it was approximately six or more as needed. We have changed that language to 6 to 12. The most times you all have met in the past few years was 11. And so this just kind of broadens that language to expect to maybe have more than six meetings, especially as we do UGB analysis, but then also keeps it flexible to say, or more as needed. But we haven't had more than 11 in the past few years. So, and then we just that we aim to follow Oregon public meetings law procedures, even though we aren't subject to them. Let's see. And then this piece, Mark sent an email earlier that just to clean up the language a little bit more, that maybe this footnote isn't necessary because it says kind of just helps define what a quorum is or a majority. So Heather proposed maybe just saying a quorum shall consist of a simple majority of EETAC members, and then we can get rid of the rounded up to the nearest whole number language and the footnote. So I think that's what we'll propose, unless anyone has a problem with that. And then since we did go below our minimum in our current bylaws, it kind of left it up in the air what that meant in terms of voting. And so we wanted to clarify that in the bylaws as well and say that if membership ever were to go below the minimum of 10, that EETAC can still continue to meet and business can still occur and voting can happen if necessary. That is about it. So I don't know if there's anything else besides that language we said we'd circle back to. Sue?
I thought it all made good sense. I didn't have any issues with any of it. There are a couple of tiny little typos that I'm sure you'll catch when you do your final review, but it all made sense to me.
Okay.
Okay. So I guess what we want to decide is do we leave in the paid thing and clarify it a little bit more? Saying any demographics such as paid as part of their, paid as part of their occupation and unpaid? Phil, and then Sue and Heather.
Yeah, I'm just going to suggest that we strike the paid and unpaid. I agree with Sue. We sure wouldn't want to preclude somebody like Ed or Alexis, who both were probably, working overtime, whatever, from their day jobs, which were related to their service here on this committee. But I think it's just going to be a little bit confusing and it's not really necessary. If you need a motion to amend these as presented or revised, let me know and I'll make it. Thanks.
Heather?
The only thing I was going to say, and I'm fine with it being removed. I think it was actually intended to do the opposite, which was to make it clear that, like, we want people on the committee that are either doing it because it's part of their job or not, you know, and it's good to have a mixture. So I think it was the opposite, but I also don't, it doesn't seem like it's going to be a problem either way. So I think that's fine.
Mark.
I think since under item B of this list, it says represent themselves and or organizations in Eugene, that the concept of people serving as members of an organization that is essentially covers the goal there. And thus if we struck paid and unpaid, we wouldn't miss it.
And for me, I'm just thinking if I'm a new person on this board and I get these bylaws and I go through it and I look at that, and then I would look at the makeup of the people I'm serving with and saying, well, who's being paid and who's not being paid?
Yeah.
And that could be the question. So I will second the motion to strike. And if there's any objection, I would say raise it now. And I didn't see any hands or shouts. So all in favor of, I guess I would entertain a motion to accept the bylaws as amended.
I'll so move.
And I'll do a second. This is Dennis.
So, Elena, you've got what you want, and you're going to take out paid and unpaid.
Correct.
All right. Any other discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? And I can't see everybody, so if anybody
you
is...
can't either.
I'm just assuming it was unanimous in favor. Okay.
Great.
Thank you for that. Next up, we go to growth monitoring annual report. Again, this is Elena.
All righty. So, switch my document. I sent out this document that shows some of the key housing affordability data. And these are the key data related to housing affordability that we'll plan to include in our annual reports moving forward. You will notice that there is less analysis than there was in the comprehensive report since we just did that report one year ago. So we're comparing the new annual data to the 2012 baseline, as well as the previous year's data. And then as we do our annual reports, we'll also be adding any new data collection points. So for example, this coming year, we will be collecting data on middle housing. So this housing affordability data is all from the census. And as I noted in the document here, the city will not be using the 2020 ACS one-year data because the Census Bureau basically released what they're calling experimental estimates. And so their standard 2020 ACS one-year data basically was impacted by COVID-19. And we are choosing not to use that data. And so the most recent data that we do have, though, is the 2021 ACS one-year data. And so we are comparing that to 2019 ACS one-year data, which is what we had included in the comprehensive report and was the most recent reliable ACS data. And so I'll just kind of walk through some of these key points. So we have median household income. There's an general overview that is the same as we used in the comprehensive report. And then a pretty simple takeaway that there was a 52% increase between 2012 and 2021. And then over the short term, a 16% increase since 2019. And that these trends are similar to both Lane County and Oregon. And Dennis.
Yeah, it seemed a little bit awkward that the sentence about these numbers are similar to trends is really in reference to the long term. And the sentence before that is short term. And I don't know if the easiest solution is to move the over the short term sentence to the end of that paragraph or in the last sentence to say something about the long term numbers.
Okay.
Similar to statewide.
Yes.
Because right now I had to kind of read it again. I went, no, wait a minute. 16% is not similar to 46. But then when I read back, I could clarify what it was, but I think it would read just straight through clear.
Yes, I agree with you. Thank you for noting that.
I guess the question I have is the notation about not adjusted for inflation.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anywhere that we have numbers that are adjusted for inflation?
Yes, but I cannot think of them off of the top of my head. Do you know, Heather?
Do I know what they are? I don't know. I don't know what they are, but...
I think the census reports median household income as adjusted. And so we chose not to unadjust it so that we can compare to rent and sales prices and stuff like that, because our other numbers aren't adjusted. So that's why it's noted, because I think the census data actually is adjusted.
I guess then my question would be, so it says that our median household income is $59,338.
Mm-hmm.
What is, do we know what it is adjusted? Or is that what the Census Bureau says it is? I'm confused.
So we can get what it is adjusted, but we aren't reporting on it. But
the reason I asked
it's backwards. The adjustment is backwards in this case. So the 2021 is what is our most recent data. And so what the census would tell us is what the 2019 and the 2012 data income is adjusted to 2021 dollars.
Okay.
And so what we're just saying here is we didn't do that adjustment. The 2012 39,200 is what it was in 2012. Those are 2012 dollars. And okay. The 2019 is the 2019 in 2019 dollars.
Okay. So if somebody's looking at housing and they say you're eligible at 60% of AMI, that would be the $59,000. is the number that you're starting that AMI number at.
Yeah.
Okay. It would be interesting to know what $2,012 dollars would buy today. You know, if we were keeping pace with inflation. And I'm not saying that's our job here. That's just me. Dennis.
Yeah, it seems to me if the issue we're looking at is affordability and we're using, you know, $2,012 dollars for rents, and we should also use those same $2,012 dollars for income, because then we're comparing apples to apples, and there's not an adjustment, unless we're going to adjust rents, because what we're really looking at is affordability, which is the comparison between housing costs and income.
Yes.
That's why we chose to do it that way. And that sort of leads us into median gross rent. So again, the rent increased 42% from 2012 to 2021. And over the longer term, 90% from 2000 to 2021. But then in the shorter term, 2019 to 2021, it was an additional 8%. And so again, these are not adjusted dollars. Rick.
Am I here?
Yes.
Okay, I have a new computer, so it's the first time I've Zoomed with it. I'm a little confused in the wording, not adjusted for inflation. I don't know that even, in my mind, that shouldn't even be in there, because if you're talking about current numbers or numbers as of 2012, that's what's being said. When I read this, for some reason, I thought that you're trying to say it would be appropriate to adjust for inflation, but we're not doing it here. And I don't think that's what you're intending to say at all. We're trying to talk about 2021 dollars or 2012 dollars, aren't we? It's been a while since I read a lot of this stuff, but that's just
right.
I was confused by having those comments in there.
Well, I think the reason they are is, as I noted, that the census reports them as adjusted, and that's sort of why we're noting that they're not. But I wonder if it may be easier to reflect that in a footnote so it doesn't, and maybe it put more of an explanation so that it doesn't throw you off as you're reading the paragraph.
But doesn't the census, when they say not adjusted for, or whatever you just said, adjusted for inflation, means that they're allowing inflation to be in the numbers? They're not adjusting them back to a 2012 base number. They're letting them be whatever the numbers are, the nominal numbers currently. And that's what you're doing, if I'm understanding this.
So they're adjusting them to current dollars, to 2021 dollars. The census.
They're adjusting the 2012 numbers to
Yes. The census is, yeah.
Okay, I guess I would just maybe think about it a little bit more, because I'm not sure that those parentheses comments even need to be in the report.
Okay.
Yeah, and I would say maybe a footnote would be a better, if you want it in the report, right, put it as a footnote, because here's an example of two of us that were confused by it, and we're the most knowledgeable people on these reports.
Mm-hmm. Oop, sorry, wrong way.
Okay. I think a footnote would be, give the opportunity to maybe give a little bit more explanation as well.
Mark.
Well, Elena's comment just now was essentially what I was going to say, and that is, I think a footnote would be valuable, because there are enough people and knowledgeable enough about these ins and outs that they're going to wonder. And so a footnote would be a good way to go.
Sounds good. All right, on to cost burden households. Um, So cost burden households have slightly decreased from 2012 to 2021 from 45% to 40%, and increased slightly since 2019 from 41% to 40%. And then we also include the comparison of renter households and owner households. And more than half of Eugene renters are continue to be cost burden, 60% in 2012 and 55% in 2021. And we sort of note that part of that is due to the larger college student population that Eugene has. And then less than a third of owner households are cost burden. And that has decreased slightly also since 2012 from 31% down to 27% in 2021. All right. And then lastly, Mark.
I'm a little bit concerned about the implications of ascribing the cost burden feature of Eugene to the student population, not that that's incorrect, but only that it serves to dismiss, in a way, dismiss the concern. And particularly since it's traceable to students as opposed to non-students, I think it's convincing, that is, to readers of this, that, oh, well, that students won't worry about it because after all, they're getting an education and they're going to be fine, or some thought like that. But in doing that, we're perhaps overlooking those who are not students. And I wonder if there's some way to take that into account so that we can maintain where we want it or need it, focus on addressing non-students and their cost burden.
Okay. I hear you. And maybe there's a way to elaborate there as well so that it doesn't seem as dismissive. All right. Last data is the vacancy rate. And we originally weren't planning to include this data point in the key data for the annual report. But because, well, for a number of reasons, it does have a high margin of error, and it is a little bit more volatile than other data. But because it was such a focus of the conversation when we presented the comprehensive report, we decided to add it. And so, at least through the ACS, it was 4.6% in 2021, which was higher than the 2019 number at 3.6%, but it's also still less than the 5% that we have heard anecdotally reported over the last few years, and basically less than 5% is going to result in a tight rental and home buying market. So it's still low, but has increased a little bit, at least in the census data since 2019. Bill.
Was there any thought to breaking out vacancy rates for single unit homes as opposed to multi-unit developments? I mean, I would think you're going to get a bigger disparity between the two, and it might be worth noting. And kind of to Mark's point too, I mean, I think that we might find that, you know, because we have a great deal of student housing in Eugene, vacancies are tight for apartments, in part because we have so many students that are taking up a lot of those units that are available. So that's one question. And the other being, in the monitoring report, if I'm not mistaken, we had not only used ACS and other kind of standard sources, but I think you used Redfin for some of your sources. And I wonder if maybe, does that provide you with a little bit of a more real-time and different result, maybe a little more refined result, maybe than you'd find here just from ACS.
So in terms of breaking it up by single family or single unit and multifamily, the only data point for vacancy rate that we used in the report was from the census, and the census doesn't break that up for us. So it's just not available with the data sets that we're using. We had used Redfin and Zillow for median sales prices for housing, but we hadn't used that for vacancy rate. So we just used a census, and then we kind of included sort of this similar information about how we've anecdotally heard from realtors and appraisers. I know when those conversations came up, people were noting, because I think, you know, the chamber had done a report recently, right before we had presented the comp report, with like a 1.5% number, something that was even much lower than the census data, because the census data is going to lag more than more local available data. But the census data is what we're using in the report. And so I think that's how we can compare numbers, but we just, you know, we can include as much context as we can locally.
Excellent. Other comments or questions about the annual report?
This is just the housing affordability data related to the census. There's much more to come. Heather.
I had one thing, Elena. You and I didn't talk about this, but vacancy rate made me think of it, because most of the housing affordability data, we didn't have an adopted assumption for in the UGB analysis, but vacancy rate we did. That was an average over 20 years of vacancy rate being 5%. Is what we were projecting. And we didn't have that on the chart for the annual report of what we were just looking at. And so I was wondering, we will have the adopted rate in that table, which I'm going to show you in a minute, that table of all of our assumptions. It has our adopted assumptions and then basically the data that Elena was just showing. It will be the 2021 data. So you would be able to get that there, but I'm wondering if we should add that bar anytime we have an adopted forecast. I'm wondering if we should add that bar in the annual report for comparison. I like that, but I also think what that would do on that chart is it would be 2012, 2019, because that was last year's data, 2021, and then adopted forecast. Would that be odd? So I just wanted to get people's hit on that. Sue?
I think it could be odd. I mean, anything that creates too much confusion, I think, is potentially a problem. So whatever we can do to simplify that, but also at the same time, provide opportunities for people to understand. So I guess I would trust staff's judgment on that. Sometimes too much information is just too much information. But I trust your judgment on that.
Well, and as we'll talk about when we, it looks like we'll have time to talk about the annual report. This is a struggle about how much to limit in the annual report, but then still make the annual report meaningful. So,
Bill.
I guess just again, two quick things. One is we're still using single family, multifamily. I thought we were going to use single unit, multi-unit, right? So, got to get our terminology square. I'm trying to correct myself, right? Are we still using single family?
So we kind of just chatted about this. The census still uses single family. And so for our own permits, we will be using single unit, multi-unit. But I think in the census charts, it's going to stay that, and we're going to have to address that in the text.
Understood. And I guess it kind of gets me to the other thing I was thinking about was like, okay, so we've got the school data here of, affordability, vacancy. Is production numbers, permitting, and so forth also going to be part of this report? And we're just not seeing it right now.
Yeah. This was just like some of the first initial data that we had, the 2021 ICS. Right. But I've been reviewing all our building permits and looking at our data and playing with Tableau, and those numbers will be coming to you.
Sweet. Thanks.
And Heather, for the input that I would have would be leave it, census, and the reason I say that is because, it might be good for this year because we have it, but 5 years from now, if we have census, it's consistent. And if we throw in other bars, it monkeys it up a little bit. So I think, it would be good for this 1 year because we got more data, but then we kind of get into that hole that we got into when we started all of this, is like which census data do we use, right? Or which population thing do we use? Oh, well, there's a new one today. Let's use that one. So I think if we just keep it all straight, that's where I'd like to see it go. So are we done here? Everybody likes the way the start of this report is going? I do. Okay, then we're going on to our next agenda item, which is growth monitoring format of the annual report.
Okay, so I was going to start with the report, but I think the first thing I'm going to do is show you just as a reminder of what the key data is. Oh, I hate it when I can't see. Okay. So you can see this document. Can you see the key data? Okay. So this is This is the table that we had in the comprehensive report. It was I don't think it was an appendix, but it was right after, it was relatively up in the report. It was like the executive summary and then the recommendations. And then we had this table that takes all of the data under each of the topic areas and compares the adopted forecast, or if it wasn't adopted, kind of like the census, most of the census data, there wasn't an adopted forecast, but there was what the data we had at the beginning of the monitoring period, and put that in these columns. And then we had the monitoring data information here. And just at a very high level, how, if you just compare those two bookends, have we seen things higher, lower, big, small, using those kinds of adjectives to describe what's happened over the monitoring period for this metric. And so you may recall that we went through and said, okay, for an annual report, we can't update all of the data. We have to pick key data that we're going to report on annually. We just don't have staff capacity to do that. And so so the first thing we did is we started with this table and just started editing it. So I just wanted to kind of show you and we'll be bringing you these topics as we go forward. But I think the next time we come to you, we'll be talking about population and employment growth. We're waiting for the employment department to put out their employment forecast, because I'd like to do that discussion all at once. But anyway, it's just light edits to this, essentially. And that will include, we were just talking about median household income, median rent, all of this that Elena was just talking about, those numbers get put in here. And so vacancy rate is down here somewhere. Oh, wait, did I add it? Maybe I haven't added vacancy rate. Oh yeah, it's right here, sorry. Vacancy rate we added. It sounds like you all think that's a good idea to go ahead and report on that annually. So we've got that in here. And so that bar that I was mentioning adding to the chart, we don't really have to add it annually because we have the 5% here in this table if we want to know what the adopted forecast was. And so you were, so all of these efficient housing development, mix of new housing, none of this has been updated yet because we don't have those numbers yet. But I'm just showing you, these are all data points that we're going to be bringing to you. So we really have quite a bit of information to bring to you, because so much of the data that is in the report is about building permits, right? It's housing mix, it's employment permit types, it's BLI impact, efficiency measures, all of those things. So those, we still have all of those to come to you. But anyway, that's what this looks like. It's a truncated version of the one that's in the report. And so the report, okay. So, as you may recall, we used this concept of an onion. I like my, as you guys know, my fruit and vegetable analogies. We use this concept of an onion with the report and the appendices. So the report starts out with an executive summary, high level, no charts, some infographics. And then you want a little bit more detail, you peel that away and you get to the snapshots. Still in the report, those have more detail, more analysis, and a couple of charts, a couple of key charts, but not all of the charts. And then if you really want all of the charts and all of the data sources and all of the analysis, you go to the appendix. And so we were trying to figure out how to make the annual report something that we have capacity to do, with it also still being useful. So the way I think of the annual report that we're going to be looking at this time is it's kind of nice because we just did the comprehensive report. So there really isn't a lot of new analysis that we would be tempted to do anyway because we just did the comprehensive report. But if I think about the annual report 3 years from now, and say, you know, we're not ready to do a comprehensive report yet, and our comprehensive report was from 2021, you might be tempted to do a little bit more analysis. And so what is the point of the annual report? The point of the annual report is to, you know, keep tabs on key data, and also to help us think about, you know, if there's red flags. So for instance, let's say middle housing code amendments just passed, that those passed after the comprehensive report. And let's say our annual reporting 3 years out showed no new middle housing. I mean, that wouldn't be the case because we've been allowing duplexes for a long time, you know, but maybe there's no new cottage clusters. That's a new use through the code amendments. And so we might go, raising a flag, why, you know, or if we had just readopted MUPTI, and again, there was no new housing with MUPTI, we might raise the flag. So that's how I think of the annual report. It's keeping a pulse on key data, and it's also just trying to find those red flags, or not even necessarily red flags. Maybe they're just orange or yellow. So with that in mind, there were basically two ways that we thought about taking the comprehensive report and shrinking it down and making it into an annual report. So option one is, and just ignore a lot of these track changes. Some of them are surgical, but like there won't be an intro letter from the planning director. But basically what option one is to just do the executive summary and turn that into basically an annual summary. And so just as a reminder of what that looks like, it's this type of information. So you've got some infographics, you've got some pictures. We would be lightly editing the numbers like Elena was showing. So comparing the baseline data to our most recent data for just key data. And then all of this analysis, because there was some analysis, some analytical summary that was in the executive report, the executive summary about fertility rates and population, age, students, all of those things, that really kind of goes away. That is the comprehensive report. That's where you're really doing the analysis. Again, this is just like checking for the pulse. And in the original comprehensive report, there were no charts in the executive summary. And so if we only did the executive summary, we'd have to probably put some charts in here. So that's what this is showing. The second option is to go ahead and do all of this, keep the executive summary, and again, lightly edit it this way. Well, it's not really lightly edit the numbers, and then get rid of the analysis again. Don't insert any new charts, but then go all the way down to our snapshots. I know we haven't looked at population yet, but I'm just using this as an example because it's the first one. And population, the snapshots, remember, is where we have our key questions. So we keep the key questions, we keep the terms, you know, we keep this snapshot framework, we lightly edit it, but again, you're getting rid of most of the analysis. But there is an opportunity here. That's where you might say, okay, there's a little bit more analysis or a little bit more explanation, not analysis. And then you might put in a key chart here. And then, you know, the nice thing about keeping the snapshots is that you could still have a couple charts. It does maintain that onion layer framework that we've kind of built into the reporting system. And you have these breadcrumbs for the appendix. The interesting thing is that if we keep the snapshots, and even in the executive summary, there's some things that we're not updating because really they don't make sense to update on an annual basis. So like demographic information, age information, race and ethnicity. Those don't make sense to update. They don't change very fast. And your best data is really from decennial data on that anyway. So, you know, we would keep the household demographics section, but we would basically say, you know, look at the comprehensive report. You know, we really don't have that information right now for an annual report. So I just want to show you the appendix, and then we can come back and kind of have a general discussion about what makes sense for those. So those are the two options. And I think the second option, where we have an executive summary and the snapshots, is where we're leaning, even though it makes things a little bit longer. But that could definitely change given the two options with the appendix. So the appendix, the first option is to have the appendix. So just as a reminder of what, let's say, population looks like for the appendix, population growth. You have the overview, you have the data source. Most of that doesn't change. I do have this highlighted because we might have, you know, if in the event that we had a new forecast, but the relationship to the model, all of that initial context information doesn't change in the appendix for the annual report. So the first option is that the takeaway section, which is really where you would be seeing data being updated, is it is that we are not updating the appendix at all for even the key data charts and key takeaways. The appendix becomes like a generic reference tool that would mean that most of the key data charts would need to be in either the snapshots or the executive summary if we took that approach. The other option is to go ahead and update the appendix for just the key data. So that's what this is showing, is that the takeaway would be, you know, the charts below include the updated data since the last monitoring report. Population growth has been about the same, even with the new, you know, data from this year. And then we would update these charts. And so we would update those, but then when you get down, you get rid of all of the analysis that we had in the comprehensive report appendix. But then when you got to, for instance, population by age group, that's not one that we're updating for annually. And so what it would say is that this data is not updated annually. Please see the comprehensive report. So the two options for the appendix might, or whatever we think is the best option for the report, might impact the appendix. Couple of things about the options with the appendix. Doing a generic appendix is pretty easy. We just strip out the takeaways, strip out the charts. It sits on the website and we point people to that for information about data sources and why we're monitoring these metrics. And so that's pretty easy. It just becomes a reference tool. And it also keeps the report, even if it's an executive summary and the snapshots, it keeps that shorter because you don't have this big appendix with it. It also could be confusing to have the appendix only have certain charts updated and not all of them updated. So you'd be saying, like in the population example, you'd be saying, yeah, here's the population growth charts and our updated analysis. But then when you get down here to population by age group, we'd be saying, sorry, we didn't update this data. Go look at the comprehensive report from 2021. On the other hand, I'm not sure, you know, that we want to put all the key data charts in the report. You know, again, with that concept of not, you know, some people aren't going to want to look at all the charts. And really with building permit data, we are going to have quite a few key data charts. Most of the efficiency measure charts, most of the housing mix charts, most of the buildable lands inventory charts, there's a lot. And I feel a little bit uncomfortable pulling all of those out of the appendix and putting them in the report when that's not where they were before. So, you know, I'd love to get your guys's hit. I know that was a little bit all over the place, but yeah, it's just hard to know what would be less confusing and consumable on an annual basis for the general public. So that's just gonna leave it at that.
Well, I'll go ahead and weigh in. I guess I'm looking at it as we've got a comprehensive plan that just came out a year ago. And so this year is easier or has less change, but we've got to think that this is the template that's going forward for an annual report. And so I don't know if there's an opportunity to do every other year you update the appendix and do it that way. Or every 3 years you do it so that we've got those good data points, but it doesn't have to be done every single year to cut down on the work. I don't know what the best balance of that is. I am concerned, or I'm not concerned, but I would like to know key topic areas, like especially like efficiencies. When we start getting into UGB analysis, you know, if we have data that we're not updating until 2 or 3 years later on what efficiencies are working, those are going to be key data points that I think will be helpful. So, you know, maybe it's truncated every other year and gone bigger. I don't know, but it's a quandary.
Yeah, so let me respond to that. I'm just going to share my screen again. I'm glad you feel the quandary as well. So these are key data points that we said we would report on. And so, and what report on means annually is what we're trying to determine right now. I think that's a really good clarification, John. Like, is this enough, right? Because we do have efficiency measures here. We will, you know, again, this is the old data. It hasn't been updated yet, but we will have how many dwellings have been built downtown, how many dwellings met the projected need, the additional dwellings in R2. We will have all of that in this document. And so if we didn't put the charts in the appendix, maybe that would be okay. And we would just pick like an overarching chart to include in the report. And it's not a whole bunch of individual charts. I don't know, but I hear what you're saying and just wanted to point out that I think even if we don't update the appendix or the report with all of the charts associated with each of these key data points, we will still have that information annually in this table. And in the snapshots and executive summary, if that's what we decide to do.
Yeah, and that sounds good to me. I guess the thing that I would want is when we start doing the URA analysis, we'll need a complete appendix, probably would be what I'm saying.
The UGB analysis?
Yeah.
Yeah, we'll have to have all update as up to date data as we can. Probably, you know, through the whatever the end of the last year is. So for the UGB analysis. Yeah.
So then lastly, what I would say is whatever makes it easiest on staff and can convey the most amount of information would be where I would land.
Dennis.
Yeah, as a general public guy, I would say the notations for key indicators of whether or not they're on pace, above or below pace, answers the fundamental questions. And, you know, a more deep analysis is kind of how far off are you? But even you can get a taste of that just from that summary kind of format that you shared. And I suspect if people are needing more nuances, decision makers, council, for example, then staff could, you know, provide additional information as needed beyond that general summary, you know, and then when other agencies, bureaucracies who need that detail for that urban growth boundary, that it's provided when needed.
Rick.
So I kind of thought, and sorry, I've been gone for a while. So if I remember right, we're going to redo the comprehensive every 5 years. Is that okay? So, I mean, to me, what I thought the annuals would be is sort of a report card of what we thought we were going to do and what's actually happening in comparison over the 4 years in between. And then all of a sudden you come back. Because a lot of the data is going to move only slightly during the couple of 3 years in between. And it just seemed to me that you need to put a lot of energy into it to report just every year when a lot of that data may only move slightly. And I kind of agree with Dennis that it's, you know, you sort of show what you want. If somebody needs more, they go get more and you've got it available. So it's not like you're hiding it. It's just, a lot of people, I don't think, are going to want to just read long data sheets after long data sheets year in and year out. It's just going to be, I don't care because there's not that much change. So I would suggest making it as bridged as possible, which works well for you guys that way. And as long as we keep the data rolling, we've got it available to us if we really need it for something that pops up that we weren't aware of.
Sue.
So I think there's both a short-term and a long-term way to look at this. The short term is that we haven't done it before. So all of this is new and a lot of the data collection points are new and haven't been collected before. So I sort of see like the next 2 or 3 years as being very critical in terms of just verifying that the collection process works and that the data is being collected the way that it needs to be collected and recorded the way it needs to be corrected. And then perhaps over time, there are more years in between because you would be looking at bigger trends. So I just am a little concerned. I think in the beginning, it's really important that we establish all of the habits and the protocols so that we're clear that the process is working. And then long-term, it can be more relaxed and maybe less staff intensive.
Can I ask a clarification on that, Sue? So we are still going to be collecting all the data and analyzing it. And so if I'm hearing you correctly, and thinking about what other people said, I wonder if there is a happy medium where we are bringing more charts to the EETAC to look at and do exactly what you said, like make sure that nothing looks out of whack. It looks like our collection is still working correctly. And actually also gives us an opportunity to review all the data together still. But then what goes out in the report is more truncated and for public consumption, because I do agree. I think we still need to review our data. We need to review it anyway, because if we're looking for those red flags, we have to review it. And it means there might be some data that we put in the annual report that we don't normally, because we're like, hey, this was weird. You know, we need to flag this. The other thing is there's gonna be the community data dashboard that Elena and our tech staff are working really hard to get that published in the next couple months, and maybe less than that, but that's what I'm saying right now. We had to kind of revamp it from the last time we talked, because these things always happen with technical things, it seems like. But that's another platform where if we want to put more charts just on, out for public consumption that we've reviewed, but it doesn't have to be in the report, you know, and those will be rolling and updated regularly. So that's another opportunity. But did that make sense? Would that meet what you're saying?
Yeah, absolutely. No, I support that. Yeah. Sounds very good.
Can I make a proposal? So I wonder, you know, you guys are going to have to look at the annual report. This is just, you know, we're trying to get a template together. So I think what I'm hearing is that people do like the table, and the table will have all of the key data in it. It doesn't sound like folks think we need to update the appendix, or I haven't heard anyone say they think that we need to update the appendix right now. Correct me if I'm wrong. And so the question is about the report itself. Certainly if we add the snapshots in, it's going to be longer. If we more do just an annual summary, it's going to be shorter. And we could put normally the one time we did a monitoring report, there weren't really any charts in the executive summary, which would become an annual summary, but we could pick a subset of the key data charts and put those in the report, the executive summary, and not do the snapshots. That would be the smallest way we could do the annual report, I would say.
I think for me that sounds good. And just kind of pick out the, you know, for the charts that you do want to put in, go back to when you presented the thing to council and dive into the ones that they were most interested in, right? And maybe those are the ones that highlight, and any other ones that you think are appropriate. But, you know, I think that would be a good way.
And I think if we draft the annual report, we bring that back to you and you guys are like, I have questions. I have more questions. That would be a good bellwether for me that it's maybe not enough.
Bill?
Yeah, I mean, I think you're on the right track. And, you know, from the comments that you're getting from other members, we're going to geek out on all this stuff and we're going to get lots more data. And you don't need to You know, it's like sometimes you read a book and, you know, the author puts all of their research into it, which they don't need to. It makes it up for a snooze of a read. I think, you know, having the snapshot, I think, is a good way to go. As you presented it, populating it maybe with some greater detail in a few tables that really are, you know, something where the dial has moved. I mean, that's where you want to focus on, where maybe things, if things are trending along as we've been forecasting, you know, you've got it kind of referenced in the snapshot. You don't need to bore people with another table to just tell them what they've already seen and can pick out from that little snapshot. So that, I think you're on the right track. And I want to try to do this in a way that is most efficient for staff's time, and also most efficient for the reader to be able to impart and get the information that they need and, you know, is most relevant and most important for them to get. I mean, Churchill was given a book once from a friend to review, and he said, it was like this thick, and he said, this book by its very size defends itself against being read. You know, we don't want to, like, put this appendix out every year that people are just going to toss it, you know, and they're just not going to look at it. So
okay, so do you have the direction that you think you need to move forward?
I think so. Although, Phil, you were saying snapshots. Did you mean the executive summary and the snapshots, or
no? I mean, kind of as you had the little dealy about you know, we're higher or lower, and this is kind of that little chart. That's what I was referring to. Yeah.
Okay, great. Yeah, I think so. And again, like Sue said, this is the first time we've done an annual report. So we'll bring you guys a draft. You know, we're going to keep, you know, as you saw on the agenda, the next steps are that we have multiple data sets to bring you. We started with housing affordability because we were ready with that data, and we wanted to bring you the most up-to-date data. So, you know, I'm kind of waiting for the employment department to give us our new forecast. But we'll just keep bringing you guys that data set, which helps us populate the annual report, and then we'll bring that to you guys and take your temperature on that.
Phil, do you still have your hand up?
Just one other comment. Yep. I mean, I think, you know, like Rick was saying, you know, when you've got a 5-year period to go through, and the state's going to require all sorts of different things that you have to, you know, flaming hoops you're going to have to jump through. So we're going to go through all that business in great depth, and we're going to have a lot more data maybe than really we kind of people are well served to maybe keep digging. The onion analogy, keep digging for the more data that you want. It's there. We're not hiding anything. It's totally transparent. But also, you don't want to really kind of put barriers up for people to be able to get the information. You want to boil it down in a very digestible pieces here, especially in these next, you know, intervening years.
Dennis and then Sue.
Yeah, just a quick comment. Last night at Sustainability Commission, we drafted a letter that's going to the council, and the council member on that commission is Councillor Semple, and she said, this letter's too long. We have to read too much stuff. So I think it's important that decision makers need information that they have the ability to digest. And I think that's the key piece that staff are going to be able to provide in this annual report, to see how decisions that have been made begin to have an impact. And then, you know, further data can follow. But is it heading things in the direction that decision makers hoped it would head or not?
Sue.
I was just going to say, well said, Philip, and I'll say well said, Dennis. Yeah, I agree with both of their comments.
Excellent.
I'm going to look for an opportunity to share the Churchill quote. I love that one.
All right, so Heather, you got what you need? Excellent. We're cooking right along here, guys. We're already to item number 5, which is next steps, and you only got 5 minutes, you guys. So
yeah, so kind of went through this, but if you all, well, I'll just go ahead and share my screen. Okay, so next steps. You know, those are our buckets. Actually, I guess we'll be able to take the annual report template off this list. So that's great. Thank you for your input. Elena, do you want to talk at all about the building permit review that we've been doing? Just as it's happening, I guess.
Yeah, I kind of mentioned that earlier. Yeah. We're doing some building permit reviews, and that goes back to June 2021. That was the last time we had done our backfill review. And I have finished all of the review through 2022. And so just working through some of the Tableau hiccups a little bit to get our charts in order and stuff. But yeah, review is done.
So that may or may not be our next topic. Definitely population and employment growth. We are hoping though that we'll be able to dig into the building permit data next because it's so many different components. And then once we have it all together, we'll bring back an annual report. So I think those are our next steps, and we'll just start bringing you additional data as it's ready.
Rick.
Sorry, I don't remember. Are you planning to include changes in building costs in our reports? The reason is I think it would be interesting for as we look at affordability and housing costs and everything, or housing values and so on, to let the reader know that what's happening with the cost to construct either single or multifamily or multi-units. Because certainly the cost of building in the last decade has skyrocketed, which accounts for a lot of the discussion when you talk about rent levels and things like that, just the sheer cost of things to get stuff done. Might be an interesting way to be able to tie it to other items that are within the report.
Yeah, so I do think, not for the annual report, but right. I do think right. that we should probably start a list of things. I mean, we have a couple years, but I bet we'll actually get some of that information out of the UGB analysis as well, because we'll be looking at redevelopability. And, you know, market trends and things like that. So I would think that that would come into the UGB analysis a little bit. But yeah, we'll need to figure out what additional things need to be in the comprehensive report and, you know, maybe keep a running list of that. And if there's also, if there's things that we could take out, right? Because we can't keep, I'm going to use that Churchill quote, you know, we can't keep making that report bigger and bigger. So it could be a footnote. It could be, you know, something like that. I mean, that's what we did a little bit, like Phil was bringing up the Redfin, you know, we used Redfin, we used Zillow, but they were pretty small statements that we had, you know, we didn't include charts from them. It was like, yeah, we double checked that. And so we did use a lot of footnotes in the report, but that could be one we add.
So I'm just gonna ask a question here. And the reason is so I was down on campus today and Smith Family Bookstore is now gone as of today. 7-Eleven's gone. Glenwood's gone. Excelsior will be gone by Friday. And I guess my question is, do we want to look at, you know, all of these big things are being built on commercial now, right? It's like the most buildable land that we have is zoned commercial. So when we start looking at efficiencies, rather than zoning from R2 to R3 or something like that, do we want to look at efficiencies as changing to commercial? Because the that seems like it's the one that is being utilized the most for housing. I don't know. You see it, all these new things that are going up, they're not going up on R4 very much. They're going up on commercial. Just an anecdote, because literally I was down there watching them tear down 13th Avenue. Rick and then Sue and Heather.
Well, John, the reason that is because it's location, location, location. It's located next to the University of Oregon, and all these equity groups have zeroed in on universities as being the hot spot to build these high-rise multifamily or student housing projects, and that's what they're selling to all the equity investors, because the stats say that student growth is going to be amazing over the next decade or two because of the demand in the high-tech sections. So they're buying ahead of time, just like retail and everybody else does. So I don't think if we put commercial somewhere else that they're going to go somewhere else to build on it. That would be my thought.
Sue, then Heather.
Yeah, I was just going to say that we're treading heavily into the policy conversation, and I would really warn that we should not be going that direction. It's murky waters, it's complicated, it's beyond our purview, and I personally do not want to get involved in it in this group. I think it's just too messy.
So yeah, thank you. Yeah, that's what I was gonna say. That's really a policy conversation. But I will make the link of where this group would get involved in that conversation would be the technical analysis that would come from any efficiency measure policy decisions. So more to come on that. The first thing we have to do before we get to efficiency measures is to do our buildable lands inventory, which Thea has already started working on, redoing the one that we just did for growth monitoring, but redoing that for adoption. And then a housing capacity analysis and a housing needs analysis. So what's our demand for the next 20 years? So all this growth monitoring data is going to inform that document, as well as the economic opportunities analysis. Again, what's our demand? How's that compare to our supply? So we have to go through I've estimated a year and a couple months of analysis and review before we get to efficiency measures. But the timeline, it's a good thing to mention. I mean, I think that we're thinking approximately 2023 in terms of this group and the UGB analysis, technical analysis review. Would be looking at the BLI, which we kind of just did. So it's a refresh of that. Looking at the new housing and employment documents, the demand documents. And then 2024 would be if there's an unmet need in either of those areas, which growth monitoring estimated that there would be an unmet need. We would be looking at efficiency measures in 2024. But what has to happen first is that policy discussion about what are the efficiency measures we need to look at, and then the technical analysis would come to this group. And then 2025 would be, if there's still an unmet need, where would we be expanding into, what part of our hopefully adopted urban reserves areas would we be expanding into? And again, that would come to this group in the context of the technical analysis associated with that. So, but there will be other opportunities to participate in the policy discussion, whether that's at Planning Commission or public outreach events or through other organizations that you're affiliated with, there will be lots of opportunities for the policy discussion outside of this group.
Okay, anything else for next steps? It looks like we've got a couple meetings in February, the 2nd and the 16th. Do you anticipate both of those being necessary?
It's a good question. You know, we always ask you guys to go ahead and hold that first Thursday. I don't know. I really don't know. It's going to depend on if we can get the building permit data in a good place that we can actually send it out to you ahead of time. That's going to be the tricky part, to be able to send it a week in advance and make sure we feel comfortable with what we're sending you. I feel like the first February one is very tentative. The regularly scheduled third February one is more likely. Okay. Elena, would you agree?
Yes. Okay. That's in 2 weeks. So
yeah, I mean, we should probably just say it's not going to happen. Let's call it. We're going to call it right now.
Thank you.
Thank you for your flexibility.
Because if we, you know, we want to stay under that 10 to 12 meetings a year, right? That we just put in the bylaws.
It's definitely not a target either, just so you know.
Okay. Anything else for the good of the order? All right. Well, thank you, everybody. We got out a little bit early. We will see you in a month.
Thanks, everyone. Good to see everyone.
Bye-bye.